hand out parking tickets and leave me alone. Stick to something you know about.
Listen, my daughter was about your age. Then she met a guy like you. Now she's dead.
You should believe in ghosts, pea brain.
He's a closet!
This is all the whiskey you possess?
Everyone out of the way of the bulldozer!
Hello, and welcome to Hello, This is the Doomed Show. I am Richard. Folks, we're back with another So Low episode. It's so low, it's basically in the sewer. I am continuing with my top 10 lists. I guess this is what I do now. Last time, I was talking to you guys about my top 10 favorite horror films and my top 10 favorite Asian horror films from way back in 2010, back when I was just 9 years old. So here it is. It's freaking 11 years later. I'm a ripe old 20, and it is time. Sorry, my cat's tail is whipping me while I'm talking. It's time for me to talk about my top 10 horror films, but put the brakes on. That's the sound of brakes. I was doing my list and I was like, damn, there's a lot of slashers in this list. So in order to extend this painful process, I have now extracted all of the slashers from my top 10 favorite horror films of all time to a new list called my top 10 slashers. And that's what this episode's going to be about. I have 10 films picked out, and I have a whole bunch of runners-up on here. Like a lot of runners-up, like a lot. Now, folks, if you've been following this show, you may remember that Brad and I recently did the most dreaded word in the lexicon of hipster hate and film fan hate words, which is underrated. I said it. I'm not taking it back. Brad and I did our favorite underrated slashers. So, and I'm sure that he and I have done like a favorite slashers list before on some anniversary episode or some random slasher episode. We did our favorites, but I was doing this list and I felt like I'd found a lot of things that I don't know if I've touched on this show before. So I'm pretty confident in this list. I've got some weird stuff here. So without further ado, my chair just made a horrible farting sound. That's not my butt. So what was I talking about? Oh yeah, I got a list. So before I go from 10 to 1 of all the favorites, I'm going to do my 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. Okay, 13. I've got 13 frickin' runners-up, so I'll do those first in no order. I will say this. It was hard to limit to 13 runners-up because I'm such a huge fan of slashers. But I did my best, so let's go. First up is a film called Night Screams, which I talked about very briefly with Brad in our underrated slashers discussion, and he found it very amusing that I couldn't remember Night Screams. I kept throwing out plots, and he's like, no, that's not Night Screams. That's Evil Laugh. I'm like, okay, was it the one with Blobbity Blue? He's like, no, that's also Evil Laugh. So I actually took a look at Night Screams to remind myself, you know, what I liked about it, and B, how it's not Evil Laugh. But you'd think that Evil Laugh would show up in this frickin' list, so... Yes, Night Screams, 1987. I stand by it. It's not a top 10, but I really enjoy it. It's one of those ones I suspect will get a proper Blu-ray. The old, I think it's an Image Entertainment DVD. It's all old full frame, watchable, but not great. And I know there's a lot of dark scenes in it, so that never endears anyone to a slasher when you can't see the movie. Next up, I'm going to go ahead and put all these Christmas favorites, you know, because it's December. I'm thinking about all of my favorite holiday slashers. So I'm going to go ahead and put my Christmassy ones right in a row here. First up is To All a Good Night from 1980. The David Hess of Last House on the Left fame directed a slasher movie that I love very much. But if you want to check out Simon and I talking about To All a Good Night, that episode was a while ago. It was number 168. If you go to doomedmoviethon.com, go to the podcast link there, and it has our archives. And yes, it is great. The episode of Simon is great. Everything's great. Next up, another Christmas favorite slasher is Christmas Evil from 1980. Brilliant stuff. Never gets old. I literally never get tired of this film. It's just so wonderful. Another one from the Christmas zone is Don't Open Till Christmas, 1984. Half directed by Edmund Perdom until he either got fired or gave up directing. Or they just filmed a bunch of scenes without him. Whatever the story is. Simon and I also covered that. That is episode 194. So, you know, Simon just dominating the Christmas season for y'all. Moving out of the Christmas season, moving out of the holidays, is Cheerleader Camp from 1988. If you haven't experienced Cheerleader Camp yet, I highly recommend it. It's got a guy mooning people out of a bus window. It's got a rap song that's incredible. It's got kooky characters. Just, you need to get on that Cheerleader Camp stuff. I made a bunch of friends watch it. First of all, yes, I have friends. And I made them watch Cheerleader Camp, and it went over like gangbusters. Speaking of 1988, it is Hack-O-Lantern. Hack-O-Lantern is yet another film that Jeffrey introduced me to on this show that really helped warp and disturb my tastes. Let's see, what episode was that? I'm sure that this one's in the archive as well. Yes, episode 141, Hack-O-Lantern, Jeffrey and I talking about it. I'm just a huge, huge fan of this film, and it's great. The mix of live sound and dubbed characters, more goofy characters, one of the worst moments of comic relief from a literal stand-up comic, a party for the townsfolk of a small community that, as they're decorating, you think it's for children. Then when you get to the party, there's no children, it's lots of adults, and there's a stripper, and there's a snake charmer woman who's also sort of a stripper, so very confusing. Next is another Jeffrey episode. This is funny. We've talked about it all. Bloody Moon, 1981. This was so close to being in my top 10, and then I remembered the horrific snake murder. So anybody out there, if you like snakes, you'll have to cover your eyes for when they freaking kill a snake, and it's terrible. And it lingers on this dead snake. Hate it. But Bloody Moon, absolute classic. And that's an oldie right there. Jeffrey picked that one for... Oh my gosh. Dude, I can't even find it. How long ago was Bloody Moon? Oh, wow. Episode 64. So yeah, check out that one. You can hear how Jeffrey pronounces Bloody Moon. That's how he does it. Next up, House on Sorority Row. From 1982, my favorite sea pig of all time is in that movie, and it's just gorgeous. Man, House on Sorority Row, I don't know what else to say about it, it's great. This will make Simon very happy. After we did our Nightmare on Elm Street series, I looked back on, you know, what of the Nightmare on Elm Street films do I love, and the ones I'm most eager to watch, and that was Part 2, Freddy's Revenge from 1985. Almost made the list. I love it, love it, love it. And that's one thing I want to talk about with this list and how I'm going to like work on my next big list, which is, you know, my top 10 horror films list. I should probably go ahead and pull any Giallo movies out of that list and do a top 10 Giallo list so I can extend this list-making bullshit solo episodes forever. But one of the things I'm trying to do is think about, what do I want to watch right now? What film, if I'm like having trouble picking between two films for a list or more than two films, what do I want to watch right now? What can I put on at this very moment and be excited about? And whichever one I'm more excited about watching, that's the one that's going to get chosen. So Nightmare on Elm Street Part 2, I want to watch that like right now. I'm going to stop recording and just go watch that right now. So that leads me to a childhood favorite, because there was no segue there. A childhood favorite called Tourist Trap from 1979. I kind of forget this is a slasher. I kind of think of this as a supernatural movie because it is both. It is both supernatural and slasher, and it's perfect. I saw Tourist Trap probably when I was 8 years old, 7 years old. It was just on TV late at night, and I, you know, had my little childhood insomnia weirdness, which is so funny. I can sleep like 8 hours a night as an adult. But I frickin', as a kid, I was up all the time. Maybe I'm making up for never sleeping as a child. But I'm sitting up at night watching this bizarro movie, and the reason I could remember what it was called was because they kept with those commercial breaks like, "We'll return to Tourist Trap after these messages." And I just grew to love it, and when I got back into horror movies in the early 2000s, when I really embraced being a horror movie fan, Tourist Trap was one of my first gets on DVD, and it blew my mind how it's still scary, it's still unsettling. Speaking of freaking legendary, classic, big three slasher movie franchises, Halloween. On my list of top losers, top runners-up, the not good enough for the top 10, we got Halloween 5, The Revenge of Michael Myers from 1989. In my video I did years ago, where I watched all of the Halloween movies, except for Halloween 3, since Michael Myers wasn't in it. Don't worry, I love Halloween 3. But I wanted to do all of the Michael Myers movies in one day, and I did it. And I actually like said on video that Halloween 5 sucks. And I hate that person that said that because it was me. I mean, I hate myself anyway. But dude, no. Halloween 5, The Revenge of M&M's is awesome. And I love it. I love Tina. I love the ridiculous shit of Dr. Loomis being a total psychopath. And I love the way it leads into part 6. The way it picks up from part 4. I mean, it's just so good. Next up, and I believe, yes, the last of my frickin' runners-up here is another film that Simon and I talked about, The Boogeyman, or as I've been calling it ever since, Fleabag, which when you hear the Boogeyman episode, you'll understand why I call it Fleabag. So, The Boogeyman isn't in the archives yet. It's still on the main feed over at Podomatic, and that's episode 203. The Boogeyman. And yeah, I love The Boogeyman. Another supernatural slasher. I don't even know what to say about it. It's just so perfect. I believe Simon and I did it all already. So let's take a break and get out of this loser land. And we're going to do, from 10 to 1, my favorite slashers. I'm putting my foot down and it's right up my butt.
Tourist Trap. Beautiful young people looking for excitement are tricked, terrorized, and trapped. God help those who get caught in the tourist trap.
This is not happening!
Rated PG.
This is the taste. This is the test. Pepsi versus Coke, the Pepsi Challenge. Pepsi. And all across America, more people pick Pepsi, time Pepsi. After time after time.
Pepsi Cola.
Oh, what a time. It's gonna be Pepsi now. The winning taste is Pepsi. It's gonna be Pepsi now. Taste for Pepsi's
Okay, I am back, and let's do this. Speaking of Christmas frickin' slashers, coming in at number 10, Silent Night, Deadly Night 3, colon, Better Watch Out, exclamation point, 1989. I love the first Silent Night, Deadly Night. It's great. I don't give a crap about part 2 because I hate clip show movies. I love all the stuff with Ricky, and the thought of just fast-forwarding to Ricky's scenes is so irritating. I don't care. Part 4 is the cult one that's great. Part 5 is the weird Pinocchio story one that's amazing. But somehow, Part 3 has wormed its way into my heart. It is the continuation of the Ricky storyline, and it is so broken and so boring and weird, but it has this tone that I cannot escape. Every year we watch this movie, and I get really, really, really excited about watching it. So yeah, if you haven't seen that Part 3, it just showed up on Shudder, so if you got Shudder, unfortunately, it's still in full frame, which is driving me nuts. Unless the movie was always intended to be in full frame, which maybe it was, I don't know. But I would love for a widescreen copy of that to show up someday. But the Shudder one looks good, so give it a watch. Number 9. Way back a long time ago, Brad and I did an episode called 1981 Slashers. And we're talking like, oh my God, episode 30. Jeez. We did Happy Birthday to Me. We did The Burning and we did The Prowler. And yes, in at number 9, as I probably already said, is The Prowler from 1981. This movie is so strange in a, not like a tone way, but in an almost like, who is this movie for kind of a way. One thing I really love about The Prowler is the band that plays at the big dance in the movie. They are this nightmarish, kind of like wannabe Cheap Trick merged with like, I want to say Rush, but maybe it's not Rush I'm thinking of, but yeah, they're terrible, but I love them. Whenever they cut to the band jamming one of their songs, it's a highlight for me. I also really like the band in The House on Sorority Row, other classic groups there. I might even be mixing those two bands up now that I think about it. Number 8, from the year 1986, it's April Fool's Day. I love April Fool's Day. I rented it when I was a kid, maybe like 11 or 12, because the cover looks so cool. And it is just one of those films that's nostalgic, and I'm shocked at how pretty that movie is. It's really shot very nicely. All of the kills are great. The story's great. It's perfect. Yes, the twist at the end is there. It never affected my enjoyment. It never will. I always mix it up with Ghoulies in my brain. So for some reason I've got the kids who are getting quote-unquote killed in April Fool's Day versus the people getting gotten by Ghoulies. I don't know why those movies are so closely related in my brain, other than I must have rented them around the same time and confused them back in the day. Speaking of things that rhyme with train, Terror Train from 1980 is my number 7. This one was almost higher. This is a movie we watch every year for New Year's. You know, it says that it takes place on New Year's, but I don't remember any countdown or anything in the movie. It's just a quote unquote New Year's party, that has costumes and it's really cold out. Love the vibe on this one. Love the story. It's pretty great. I actually have a Belgium, movie poster for Terror Train because an American one would be too expensive. So what's the next logical country that would have had a great poster for Terror Train? Duh, it's Belgium. Or it's just France. Maybe the eBay seller didn't know what country it was from. I don't. Speaking of Jamie Lee Curtis, speaking of the frickin' Halloween franchise, coming in at number 6, totally predictable, Halloween, : The Curse of Michael Myers from 1995. Yes, this is another one of those movies where I had to think about, okay, which of the Halloween movies would I want to sit down to watch right now? And this barely beat out part 5. I love this movie so much. I had avoided it, and it was because everyone said it was so bad. Just like Jason Goes to Hell, which, come to think of it, Jason Goes to Hell should have been in my runners-up here. But Jason Goes to Hell, it's like so supernatural and so weird that I forget it's a slasher. So go ahead and take Jason Goes to Hell and stick it right there at the bottom of this piece of paper. I have now seen both versions of Halloween 6 here, the producer's cut and the theatrical cut, enough times to remember which one is which. I used to think that I didn't care for the producer's cut. I was like, no, don't want that. I only like the theatrical one. Get that producer's cut out of my face. But then, just for fun this year, I watched the producer's cut to remind myself, you know, what is it I don't like about it. And it does come down to just the minor things that I prefer about the theatrical. So I'm still going to reach for the theatrical more than the producer's cut, but they're both totally viable options for watching that film. Yeah, I love it. I adore it. It's so 90s. Is that the first 90s thing on my list? In fact, that's the only 90s thing on my list. Spoiler alert. Number 5. We're halfway there. Brace yourself for a Mad Man from 1981. Madman, man. Love this one so much. Brad and I recently talked about it on our 1982 slashers because I really thought this was an 82 movie. We had a lot of problems with the years, and I might still be having problems with these years because I quickly Googled all these years. So if anything's off, just ignore me. I am getting worse at remembering what year things came out because it doesn't matter. This has the hot tub sequence where our heroine spins and then her boyfriend, whose name is TP, he gets into the hot tub and he spins, and it's got all these like weird hippie feel good moments in the dialogue that make you think that the script was maybe repurposed from somebody's college years. Like maybe it wasn't a slasher at all. Maybe it was a movie about like people, man, and relationships, man. And it has beep boop, beep boop, beep boop. Yeah. Highly recommend Madman. I mean, who hasn't seen Madman? Come on, people. Watch it. Number 4 from 1982. It's that bastard movie, Pieces. I want to live inside the movie Pieces. A Spanish filmmaker making an American movie, trying to make it as American as possible, with Wendy's cups and Wendy's French fry containers and goofy characters, totally nutsoid dialogue. It's pretty outrageous, and it never gets old. Pieces was going to sit very comfortably in my top 10 horror films, but I ripped it right out of there. Ripped it and put it in the slashers list because I love it. My band, Gyro Jets, has a song about Pieces. I'm super proud of that song. We will be releasing it pretty soon, officially. If you look around for it, you might find it. And if you message me and you want to hear it, I'll play it for you. But we finished the song, and then we decided we needed a bass player. So now we have bass on the song. It was one of our first songs that we added bass to and had our bass player add some extra vocals. And it's going to be this rollicking good time for all of your holiday weekend plans in pieces. Number three is a film that I have seen so many times, it's embarrassing. 1982, The Slumber Party Massacre. This is one of the best slashers ever made. It's one of the best casts ever. Certainly the best characters ever. Weird, inexplicable stuff happens. Just outrageous. One of the best villains ever. I just adore it so much. Seeing the screening, which I probably talked about last episode at Tampa Theater, was very important to me. So, you know what? I'm not going to ramble about Slumber Party Massacre. I just did. Let me move on with my life. Whew, number two. Oh my gosh, so close. Here we go. 1980s. He Knows You're Alone. I'm smacking myself on my hand. I'm being naughty because I still haven't watched that Blu-ray. He Knows You're Alone is just perfection. Brad and I covered this a little while ago, or was it a long while ago? That's where the old He's a Closet comes from. Oh yeah, episode 128, like over 100 episodes ago. Jeez. Yeah, He Knows You're Alone is so sweet and so tonally perfect. All the characters are great. All of the acting is wonderful. Freaking Colleen Camp, camping it up. Oh, man. Yeah, I'm really happy we have that on Blu-ray. And shame on me again for not having broken that out yet. Which means, folks, you're almost out of here. You're almost moving on with your lives. If you stuck around because you have to know my number one, I'm so sorry because you had to hear my voice for this whole thing. I'm talking, of course, about another classic from 1980, Prom Night. Prom Night, Jamie Lee Curtis, Leslie Nielsen, other people. It is my go-to slasher. If I happen to have a guest over in the less pandemic-y future, and they're like, I've never really seen a slasher other than Scream, I'll be like, dude, you're gonna need some Prom Night. And then we'll follow it up with all the sequels, because with the exception of the remake, all the Prom Night movies are great. Even Prom Night 4 is wonderful. Again, a movie I saw as a kid. I really, really got that movie stuck inside my DNA. I caught that movie when I was so young that it informed my taste. That's why it was so easy to do a slasher rambly list episode. And what was the only difficult part was not saying, well, every slasher? I mean, yes, there are some slashers that I really don't like. They do happen, but I'm always excited about finding an 80s or like late 70s, even into the 90s, like early 90s slashers that I'd never heard of. I love checking them out. It's my favorite subgenre. It's always battling with me, battling for my attention from the giallo. The giallo and slashers are always like on the forefront of my mind of things I want to watch all the time. And slashers, I think, are just easier. The giallo can be a little bit slower in that it doesn't jump around and wave its arms in the air trying to get your attention as much as the slasher does. But the world of Italy in the 70s is one of the greatest worlds that ever happened for my film tastes. So, you know, there's benefits to both, and they're always battling it out. So me putting off my top 10 favorite horror films for a giallo list is almost like a guarantee. But But anyway, prom night, simply perfect in every way. And Brad and I did a prom night megasode where we talked about everything except the remake. We tried to watch the remake to prepare for the episode, and it was a no-go because, you know, there's just nothing to it. I can't even, like, say I'll watch it again and give it another chance. I will never watch that again. But yes, we talked about Prom Night 2, Prom Night 3, and Prom Night 4. That was episode 76, and that is one of my favorite episodes of The Doom Show. That one and the SF Brown Rig Megasode, or SF Brown Rig Super Show, I forget the terminology there. Those are easily my two favorite Brad episodes right there. So what about, like, everything else that wasn't on the list now that I'm done with my top 10 and my losers? You know, obviously I love Scream. I love Scream 1, 2, 3, 4. I'm looking forward to the new Scream, which they should have called it 5 Cream. Since, you know, fives look like an S, I think 5 Cream would have been great. But they didn't call it that. Cowards. I enjoyed what I've seen of the Scream TV series, which was just like most of the first season. I've heard about that great third season. I love freaking I Know What You Did Last Summer. I think it's a beautiful film. Of course, I love the Black Christmas remake, the 2006 one. I need to give the 2019 one another shot. I didn't mind it. I thought it was okay. It was, I appreciated how weird they went with it by just going off on a strange tangent. That was wonderful. I feel like I'm forgetting some other slashers from the 2000s. Let's throw them in here. Well, I'm being all slashery. I know Brad's a big fan of Cry Wolf. I enjoy Cry Wolf. Of course, Rob Zombie's Halloweens. It was very difficult to keep Rob Zombie's Halloween 2 off of my list. It's a favorite. I love it. I love it. I love it. But it's really intense. It's very emotionally draining film for me to watch because I love the characters so much. Unfortunately, because I don't want to watch it more than every few years now, you know, it's also tied in with my friend Nafa, who used to co-host this show with me. And he passed away, God, almost 5 years ago now. And he and I were huge, huge fans of that film. That's always going to be a big part of my brain. High Tension. High Tension is one of my favorite European slashers. I adore it. P2 is another Christmas slasher. I love P2. Speaking of French things, I really like the Toolbox Murders, the original, and the remake, the first remake. Toolbox Murders 2 Coffin Baby, or whatever it was called, is one of the worst things I've ever seen. Yeah, that's trash. I hated it. What's one I liked recently? What was the one? Final Girls. I really think Final Girls is a great freaking slasher. Final Girl? Not as good as Final Girls. Of course, they both came out around the same time. Final Girl's good. I like the reversal they did with that one. Oh, Behind the Mask, the Rise of Leslie Vernon. Another great film that I've been meaning to rewatch. I've only seen it once, and I've really enjoyed it, and then I've not returned to it in years and years and years. I have a good feeling about revisiting that one. Oh my God, dude, Urban Legend? How did I forget about Urban Legend? I love Urban Legend. I like that better than some of the other ones that I listed. Like, I think I prefer that one over I Know What You Did Last Summer. Yeah, whew. Urban Legend, boy. Woo! And that sequel, I haven't seen the Bloody Mary one, but the final cut, that one's a lot more fun than I thought I remembered. Like, when that Blu-ray came out, I was like, okay, let's do this. And yeah, I actually really enjoyed it. So yeah, before I keep going with literally every film ever made, I'm going to go ahead and stop this. A couple announcements. I'm trying to sneak in a Christmas episode this year. Like a proper Christmas horror episode. Don't know if it's going to happen. We'll see. You'll be the first to know because you'll be listening, and I'll go, who is this? Hello, kittens. Cats are getting wild. Doomedmoviethon.com. It's a website. I run it. On the right-hand side of the website, there's a little link that says Moviethons. Please click on Moviethons, and you'll see there's a new Moviethon in there. It's called Giallo Meltdown, Slashing Back to You, which of course is a reference to the great skit from SCTV, Bouncing Back to You. Highly recommend you watch Bouncing Back to You, the SCTV bit. You'll love it. Or you'll email me like, why did you make me watch that? But I wrote about 13 slasher films from Friday night until Sunday evening. I watched that gray area where Italians and Spanish filmmakers decided to keep up with the times, and they made slasher movies that were kind of just giallo, like Pieces, like Bloody Moon. And then you have Michele Soave making an amazing slasher with freaking Stage Fright. But then at the same time, you've got all these freaking American people who are making slashers, and they might as well just be 80s giallo movies, because all the imagery from a giallo, the plots from a giallo are all there. So I wanted to walk in that gray area of slashers that are giallo and giallo that are slashers, or vice versa. So yeah, check it out. It's 7,000 words, so bring a sandwich. It is chapter 9 of Giallo Meltdown 2. I am not furiously writing this second book, the first book available on Amazon.com. I'm not furiously trying to finish this book real fast, but I'm trying to do a Moviethon every couple months so that I can have something to show for this giant stack of movies I collected for years, because as soon as Giallo Meltdown was done, I realized I'd forgotten some important films, and I had just been acquiring new things to cover in this new book. And of course, a lot of this book is exploring the giallo this time around, trying to find, it's like these giallo lists that people put up online, and the number of films that are tagged giallo on IMDb is insane. So a lot of it is filtering that stuff out, or just filtering it and seeing what really is a giallo and talking about it. And that's going to be the whole book. And I'm trying not to make it longer than the first one. I highly doubt it'll be longer than the first book, but it's going to be definitely worth your while if you liked the first one. I'm trying to improve upon Giallo Meltdown in every way I can with Giallo Meltdown 2. I'm actively trying to make it a better book, and I hope that it will show when the final thing is done. So shooting for 13 or 14 chapters, so I'm way past the halfway point. And so the new chapter is up. Give it a read. I'll probably put up at least one more chapter before I say the book is done and start editing it. I just really want folks to stay excited, because I really want to sell so many copies that I can retire, brother. Oh yeah, you know what you can't do on self-publishing? Retire. So thanks for listening, folks. If you want to email me, doomedmoviethon@gmail.com. Follow me on Twitter. Again, doomedmoviethon at Twitter. Love to hear from you. I'm on Instagram, doomedmoviethon. Check me out. And what else? That's it. Hope you guys are doing well. And bye.
This is the Doom Show is a proud member of the Legion Podcast Network. Please check out the other podcasts on legionpodcasts.com. If you'd like more, hello.